My name is Jonathan Meads. This series of films is called Abroad in Britain, and it's devoted to the proposition that the exotic begins at home.
You know how you get in Sandhurst?
Twenty-five years ago, you'd have found me here, face down on the Blackdown Hills, about 10 miles from the High Anglican School to which my parents had sent me in the hope that I might turn into a gent. I didn't. It failed.
All these brass with bristling moustaches. First thing they ask you, do you know the stuff we breathe?
Piety and playing soldiers didn't work on me. Maybe I didn't have a character to build. Had it been successful, I might today have been a passed-over major. I might have been in the army. And I'd never really have left school. That's what the peacetime army, the volunteer army, the willing army is, an eternal school with written rules and compulsory games.
Then they ask you, what do you call the stuff on top of your head?
Foliage?
More rules, more obvious rules than in any other walk of life. More gains, too.
Do you know the word for the place where beasts of prey, wolves, foxes, those sort of chaps live?
It's a sophisticated organism of perpetual pupils.
Air. Hair. Lair.
Air-hilaire! You're in!
Down there is the town of Wellington, West Somerset, from which the Anglo-Irish soldier Arthur Wellesley took his name when he was ennobled. The Iron Duke, the victor with a little bit of help of Waterloo. And this is his monument, one of his many monuments. Think of all the Wellington streets and Wellington squares and Wellington boots and mad beef Wellingtons that commemorate him, that commemorate this man who, because of his achievements, and more because of the ubiquity and variety of his monuments, is much more than a man. He's a martial ideal. He has much to answer for. For the part of England where he is most culpable, we must look 120 miles east of here. There's a limb of England where three counties, Hampshire, Berkshire and Surrey, adjoin each other in a military alliance. There, civil law and civil mores are abandoned. The wine is blood. It often is when collective delusion is the matter in hand. Up here, at the northernmost tip of the military limb, is Wellington College, whose motto is For the Sons of Heroes. Here is the Royal Military Academy at Sandhurst. Here are the ranges at Bisley. Here is the Guards Depot at Pirbright. Here is the Royal Ordnance Corps at Blackdown. Here is Minley. Here are the Gurkhas at Church Crookham. And here is Aldershot, home of the British Army. Oh, and here is Broadmoor, which is adjacent but not necessarily connected. The blood bleeds into the brick. There is no red brick redder than the red brick of the military limb. Wellington College may be a school, but it's also a program in brick, in very red brick. It's a waxwork in stone and brick. It's a memorial, a monument to the ideal of patriotic sacrifice, military sacrifice, even civilian sacrifice. Mr. Spencer Percival is the only British premier to have been assassinated so far. every brick, every stone, might bear the name of someone who died for his country. This is where the martial life begins.
The first impression was, when I was a very small boy, 13, was how, you know, how... The whole army must have been up on these walls somewhere. And then later on, one began to feel that it was very much like a... Not like a barracks, actually, because it's prettier than a barracks. Like, some sort... It has a sort of feeling of institution in every brick. It is a... It makes you feel intimidated. The numbers of generals that served with Wellington in Waterloo, one just couldn't believe how many of them, because inside that building there are hundreds of little niches and busts of the generals. You do have a feeling that this thing is a huge, great presence in your life, which it is. I don't know if a building can inculcate values. I'm not sure that they do, but certainly this expresses a number of values, and it expresses order, regimentation, the dead honoured, victories honoured, and so forth.
Look out! Dead! Attention! Get on! Break!
It always seems to be that these establishments are built on sandy soil, so you have this extraordinary, relentless evergreenness about this place, which is remarkable, because you have rhododendrons which are green all the year, pines, Wellingtonians, Scots pines, everything's always green, except in this one month when nature tells you it's spring here, and it all goes purple and violently azalea colours everywhere. So it has a very special feel, this landscape, very, very individual. And it's quite rare in Britain.
Well, soldiers usually take a great deal of pride in their barracks, in their surroundings, mainly because they're trained to do so right from the word go. It is their home, and they look after them, and they're quite proud of them. The solidarity of the buildings, they stood there four square. I mean, you can go to some places and look at the barracks. They've got a great tower. They stand there. They proclaim what I think the army was all about and what the architects of the time were trying to say. It's like this place. The Victorians built it, and they were saying, here we are, we've got this place, we had the Duke of Wellington, this is his monument. And, you know, it really is something.
As memorials go, Wellington College is not entirely pompous. If it is possible to achieve a mix of humility and heroism in a building, then it has been achieved here. But then, this is not a collective memorial. It's not Thiepval on the Somme. It's not the Osiery at Verdun. It celebrates a massively successful soldier and statesman and is dedicated to the sons of heroes, not to the mass of forgotten dead.
Pour ceux qu'on n'a pas revu, Verdun n'est plus rien.
Their name liveth forevermore is one of the great lies, perhaps the greatest lie. The names that live are those of the generals who were lucky not to get fragged. The names of the cannon fodder, forget it. Forget them. They're no more alive than the bodies that bore them.
C'est à côté. C'est une sortie dans le nord-est. Sur l'autoroute de Reims à Metz. On y va par la voie sacrée, finalement, Verdun. C'est un vieillard rusé. J'ai une tendresse particulière pour cette première des dernières guerres dépassées. Bien sûr que je n'étais pas né, je n'étais pas là pour apprécier. J'avais un vieux à Verdun, et comme je n'oublie jamais rien, je reviens.
What makes Wellington College unique among Victorian public schools, that's to say among the great mass of public schools, is the idiom in which it's built. With the exception of the chapel, which is at odds with the whole, it is untainted by the Gothic. It was resolutely against the architectural fashion of its day. The 1850s was not a propitious decade for classicism. Gothic was all the rage, not least on account of its supposedly Christian virtues. Classicism was definitely out of fashion, save in the army,
which always goes its own way. Classicism has always been the army's vernacular. There is good reason for this. Classicism shuns the picturesque and broadcasts order, symmetry, rank, hierarchy. It is a form of architecture which exemplifies martial norms.
The separateness, the hermeticism of the martial life is sealed by making everywhere that you're posted to look the same. Aldershot, Catterick, Tidworth, Colchester, Bulford, they all look the same. And you're always at home on Ramillies Drive, in Wavell Close, in Kitchener Vale, in Malplaquet Gardens.
This gym is named Maida. That's Maida, the Battle of the Peninsular War. That name has, I guess, lived forevermore, but is no more than a name. The referent, the blood, the smoke, and so on, is forgotten. The names are eventually tokens, ritual words that make up a litany of loss.
The sheer squalor of battle is normalised by this appropriation of names. It's normalised and it's also sanitised by spray on glory. Glory is a retrospective and sentimental adjustment of the actual. It's like dressing an accident victim for his coffin.
It's a device for making the unacceptable tolerable, a big euphemism. Certainly in the martial life, death is always close at hand, or rather, the dead are, which is different. The way they got to be dead, the cause of the greatest physical mutation, is forgotten. The dead are the dead. The literally vital precondition of being dead, the fact of being alive, is forgotten. The indignity of having life extinguished is forgotten. Death is forgotten. The enormity of its belligerent causes ignored. The dead get an Arcadia to sleep in. They get a bit of respect. When really it's too late. If only they could have lived in such peace.
I didn't join. I did not want to stay at school forever. I was not subjected to these buildings. I did not have to suffer architectural might. The Royal Military Academy at Sandhurst does not look the way it does by chance. Its buildings are achieved with pedagogic purpose. They are moulders of men, character builders. The words that figure big in the martial vocabulary are embodied in this pile. Drill, order, discipline, roster. And, at a supposedly higher level, fealty, honour, patriotism, etc. All of the things we hear so much about from ambitious opportunists such as politicians, who are notably lacking in these qualities. How are these dubious abstractions actually achieved? How is a building made to transmit these messages? How are they rendered plastic, visible, tangible? Of course, you need to have a prior inkling of what is being expressed. But once you have that, and the army is not hesitant about imparting bubble, i.e. intelligence, once you know what is being said, you cannot but help hear it being said over and over and over again. The building is, if you like, a sort of mnemonic. Articulated repetition is a powerful tectonic weapon. The bricks seem infinite, the windows seem infinite. There are so many of them, all the same, like so many soldiers, in fact. The building also works through its bereavements of prettiness and variety, and through its very order. The individual is subservient to the mass. This sort of building dwarfs the individual, teaches a sort of team spirit, an extreme sort of team spirit, something that is akin to collectivism, oddly enough. Loyalty to school,
loyalty to regiment. There's not much of a difference there. The martial life, like any other sort of life, is compounded of manifold paradoxes. How does team spirit, for instance, accord with the thing called initiative or leadership? The one requires that the individual make himself part of a machine, the other that he assert himself.
Again, soldiers lead the most socially sheltered, even circumscribed lives. They're cosseted. The problems that habitually face civilians, petty decisions, money, mortgages, travel arrangements, are magicked away. Everything is taken care of, as at school. But while the army suckers, and thus promotes dependence with one hand, with the other, it tries to inculcate physical fearlessness. It tries to realize a potential for bravery.
The actual tools that are employed in this process, the instruments that make machines of men, possess a curious beauty. They might be geometrically arresting lumps of sculpture, advanced installations, items of constructivist exuberance.
Essays in a sort of geological realism.
There are basically two types of specifically military icon, the ceremonial and the utilitarian. The latter may not be dressed for anything but work, but it has a function that goes beyond the merely utilitarian. Look at camouflage, which is allegedly utilitarian. Military uniforms look the way they do in order to emphasize the separateness and the specialness of the military's dominion. They're declarations of martial peculiarity. They're part of the army's iconographic code.
Uniforms came into widespread use in the 18th century so that armies looked more or less alike. Uniform needed to make people look bigger, fiercer, and sexier. Hence, it went in for things like fur, fur hats, fur embellishments, fur on the back of packs. It made people look broad-shouldered, epaulettes, padding. There's a certain style in the way that uniform is worn that goes quite beyond what dress regulations actually say. And one of the first things that soldiers traditionally do when they get issued with a uniform is to take it away and have it altered. There's a line from Kipling which goes something like, "I carried my slops to the tailor and said to him, 'None of your lip. You loosen it over the shoulder and tighten it over the hip.'" And that's what soldiers still do. Now, if we were to go across to the depot of the parachute regiment, we'd actually see berets being worn well shrunk, worn tightly on the head, with the badge well over on the left, tight trousers, uniform cinched in at the waist, making the wearer look recognizably slim and trim and fierce and fit. Most armies now wear a form of camouflaged uniform for purely utilitarian purposes, because it looks good and sensible and practical in the field. But it actually does stand out in civilian society. You look really very obvious walking about in camouflage clothing in a generally civilian setting. So ironically, what started out as camouflaging people and making them blend in has actually made them stand out really rather prominently.
And just as the apparently utilitarian possesses a symbolic function, so does the ceremonial possess a utility. Ritual is never without a purpose. What we're looking at here is built ritual, sculpted ritual.
The statue is then a utilitarian object. By it is remembered Napoleon, Prince Imperial, the son of Napoleon III and the Empress Eugenie. The family came to Britain in 1871 after the defeat of France in the Franco-Prussian War. The young prince, astonishingly, became a military cadet in the British Army, was commissioned and killed in the Zulu campaign of 1879. One might believe that the function of this work is to express relief at the extinction of the last of the troublesome line of Napoleons.
But such cynicism is not part of the official military mentality, for within it lie the germs of bolshiness and of mutiny. And besides, the actuality is not so facile. Indeed, it's rather complicated. Three miles from Sandhurst and two from Aldershot is this extravagant essay in bogus half-timbering. Or perhaps we should call that style by its French name, Le Style Normand. For it was here that the Empress Eugénie, widowed at the age of 46 and deprived of her son 6 years later, spent her 40 years of grief. Years which are enshrined less than a mile away on the other side of the railway tracks which lead to Waterloo. Here, in the middle of the most intensely militarized zone in Britain, is the mausoleum of Napoleon III, of Napoleon Prince Imperial, and of Eugénie herself. Here is a place that is forever France. Boney was a bogeyman, a bonsai nightmare who frightened generations of children. He was Wellington's supreme foe. The fortuity of the last of his family's presence here, literally in enemy lines, suggests that a sort of redemption has been granted by the British, that they have shown magnanimity towards the former enemy, that the other side of belligerence is sentimentality. Of course, Napoleon III and Eugénie were Anglophile. Of course, their 23-year-old son died in British colours. But they bore the name of the eternal enemy. And this mausoleum serves as an emphatic reminder of the idea of an enemy, the polarized threat, the guy in the opposite camp who, if he's not there, has to be conjured up. Camp. The word is the right one. As I say, one camp, one posting, is the same as the next. This is not just because of the repetition of street names, not just because the same basic model is used for quarters, messes, barracks, not even because nowhere outside camps has quarters, messes, and barracks. These types of buildings are, self-evidently, peculiar to the armed forces. But what is most peculiar about camps, what earns them their name, is their sense of impermanence, the feeling that they've been laid out without regard for topography, as if to emphasize the primacy of ranks and straight lines. Formations that suggest they've been laid out like rows of tents. It's as
though the rows of tents that were pitched on this inhospitable heath 150 years ago turned to stone, well, to brick and wood and metal. The unitary organization of the army lends itself to such formal planning. The temporariness of certain structures is manifest. But when does temporariness cease? When does the notionally temporary mutate into the actually permanent? Many temporary structures outlive those intended to be permanent. This sort of billet at least habituates its inhabitants to the rigors, if not to the precise conditions, that they may have to suffer when they go to war. The thief of Baghdad has achieved in 3 months what the Warsaw Pact failed to achieve in 4 decades. Like Galtieri before him, he's provided the possibility of a fixture rather than a practice match. But when it's over, whether or not a shot has been fired, what will Tommy do? All that Ivan wants to do is kiss and make up. The very term peacetime army is an oxymoron. An army needs an enemy. It is emasculated without one. So an army always has to invent one. The army fuels this pretense with buildings such as this, a simulacrum of a house, a toy house for playing war games in. The army gives lessons. Its men are forever on courses. They're forever rehearsing for a show which may never happen. The army is not like being at school forever just because of the rules, the games, the strict timetable, the keenness, the team spirit, the religious sentimentality. It is like being at school forever because it is a perpetual learning machine. And what do soldiers learn about? They learn about the army, which exists in order to teach men about itself. That's how it perpetuates itself, through teaching, isolation, and its insistent iconography. One day it stops for them all. School is over. And out there is this frightening place called Civvy Street, which they must walk down, alone, hand in hand with themselves, with no one to take care of them, bereft of the crutch that has supported them all their lives. The leap, of course, does not have to be too great. The fall can be broken. We're not talking about fish out of water. The military limb from Wellington College to Aldershot, from Camberley to Church Crookham, from Yorktown to Pirbright, is hospitable to old boys. They need not go too far from school. One of them had the young Edwin Lutyens build this for him. And all around here, among the pines and rhododendrons, are the villas of former military men. And above them all rises an idol, Olympian, the avatar of Mars, the Victor Ludorum, the most fated alumnus, the ferris god, the most worshipped ancestor, the model for all subsequent soldiery, the founder.